The Lord be with you. Oh, we better try that again. The Lord be with you. We are grateful for your presence this morning on the fourth Sunday of Easter on the church calendar and what the secular calendar also refers to as Mother's Day. There are a few announcements that are printed that I'll call your attention to, but let me invite you to remember or notice for the first time even that offering boxes are at the entrance and exits down front, and there is another one out the double doors at the back and the side doors for that matter in the narthex on the way to 31st Street. So if you have an offering to leave or a note to leave, feel free to place it in these boxes as you depart or if you get up at any time in the service. Also, in your pews, there are attendance pads. Are they in the outside pew, outside of the pew here? Inside. Okay, they're on the inside of the pews. And if you would pick that up and sign it and pass it to folks to the outside, if there's anybody sitting outside of you. And especially if you're a church member, if someone comes in late, signing that attendance pad is not a requirement, but it is really helpful to us because sometimes folks who come in late are visitors and we have no way to really fully welcome them. So if you think about it, just, you know, pass it over to them. The folks worshiping today are those of you and us here in the sanctuary. Also, those who are worshiping with us online through live streaming and maybe who will see the service after this particular hour when it's posted up on YouTube. And we welcome each of you. In terms of the written announcements, there is this insert to which I will call your attention in just a moment, but in the regular printed order of service, the last announcement on page 3 and the next to the last is that children are welcome in worship and there are activity bags on a post in the narthex if you would like to take the opportunity to utilize those. For those who may be thinking about membership in this church, or even what is it like to just show up at a Presbyterian church week to week, the last paragraph lists Emily's email and my email and the church phone number. So keep that handy, and if a visit that we could arrange at a mutually convenient time would be something that would be helpful to you as a visit, please be in touch with us by email or telephone. We would be honored to have that conversation, and folks are received by our elders on any given Sunday at about 10:20, just before this service starts. So we would welcome the opportunity to receive you in a formal way, but whether we are ever on the same roll or not with our names, we are together those who serve Jesus Christ through this particular faith community. On the announcement page, in the top left corner is a box in blue and yellow related to the Ukraine Mission Challenge, and offerings will be received through the end of this month, and they can be placed in these boxes. In June, I think that if everything goes according to plan, we will be resuming passing offering plates, but for right now, we're still with the offering boxes. So please note that about the Ukraine Mission Challenge and ask someone if you have questions about that. Next Sunday at 5 in the afternoon, Greg Tivis will be the artist in residence at the Carter Creek concert, and that will be, as I said, at 5 o'clock next Sunday. That announcement is in the upper right. This afternoon at 2 o'clock is a special event. We have had some Eagle Scout courts of honor in the past with our previous troop and even with our current troop, 976. But today there will be three Eagle Scouts who will receive their Eagle badges here in the sanctuary at one time in one service. R.A. Reynolds of this church, Marty Drody, and Jacob Hilland. And so while Ari's here this morning, hold these three guys up and their families in your prayers, and if you have a chance to meet them, in your congratulations, because Ari and Marty and Jacob have been faithful members of 976 from the time the troop was at Central Church until they migrated over here 2.5 years ago. And we give thanks for our shared ministry with them. Friends, we are grateful that you are here. We are grateful that God's grace reaches to us and even far beyond us. We're grateful for the opportunity to be in ministry together in the way of Jesus Christ. Again this morning, we are worshiping God.
Let me be one of, I hope, the many this morning that will wish you, or today, that will wish you a happy Mother's Day. I'm especially thankful and for my mom, and as my mom was a very black and white person, either it's right or it's wrong. And I think somehow in Michelle's selection this morning of trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey, I think somehow my mom was speaking to me from the grave this morning. So let me wish you a happy Mother's Day and tell you that I'm glad that we're here together to, and I don't know about you, but I have about 4,000 mothers, and whether we're celebrating mothers that are your maternal mothers or mothers that just kind of keep an eye on you or make sure you're walking the straight and narrow path, right, choir? And so all these mothers up here behind me, I'm thankful for all the ladies in my life who stand there and to encourage me and to hold me accountable. So thank you to all of you this morning. Our opening sentences this morning come from Isaiah 25, verses 4 and verses 8. The prophet Isaiah proclaims in chapter 25, O God, you are a refuge to the poor and to the needy in their distress. You will wipe away the tears from all faces. shame and disgrace experienced by any of your people, you will take from the earth. Would you stand and join us in singing together, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, hymn number 1.
Let us join in prayer together. Gracious Sovereign, we, your people, have built, accepted, and honored barriers between ourselves and others. We have satisfied ourselves with separation on the basis of differences. We have failed to appreciate your love bringing new life, where we have betrayed you and others, and where we have deceived, disrespected, and ignored others. Forgive us all our sin. Mend brokenness in each life and everywhere. And heal us for serving you wherever you lead, always in the way and spirit of Jesus Christ. Amen. Sisters and brothers, let us hear and share with gladness the blessed news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
You may be seated.
Our scripture reading for today comes from Revelation chapter 7, verses 9 through 17. Listen now for the word of the Lord. Let us hear God's word. After this, I looked, and there was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, robed in white, with palm branches in their hands. They cried out in a loud voice, saying, "Salvation belongs to our God who is seated on the throne and to the Lamb." And all the angels stood around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures. And they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, singing, "Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, "Who are these robed in white, and where have they come from?" I said to him, "Sir, you are the one that knows." Then he said to me, "These are they who have come out of the great ordeal. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. For this reason, they are before the throne of God and worship Him day and night within His temple. And the one who is seated on the throne will shelter them. They will hunger no more and thirst no more. The sun will not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd, and He will guide them to springs of the water of life. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Every 3 years on the third Sunday following Easter, which in the way we count Easter as number one, so it's called the fourth Sunday of Easter. But anyway, on the third Sunday after the one we celebrate is Easter, the cyclical suggested scripture readings on the church calendar include Revelation 7, verses 9 to 17. But because Easter is a movable feast, as we would say, or a movable holiday, it goes according to the moon and not according to the sun, not every fourth Sunday of Easter is Mother's Day on the United States calendar, where it's the second Sunday in May. But that is the case this year. And so, although when you think about it, Revelation 7 may not have much to do with Mother's Day, as it's part of the Easter tradition, bear with me today as we possibly work to pair up these two like they're pieces of a tabletop or a jigsaw puzzle, where maybe we can make that interlocking match. The verses from Revelation 7 are a portrait vision in narrative. You know, the words tell this picture painting that the writer hopes to stimulate in your mind or my mind, and it is a portrait of God's ultimate victory when time and history are no more. And according to this vision, as Emily helped us to read and hear, when God brings creation and history to completion, the tears of every person are wiped away by God's love and mercy and grace. For the time being, on this side of death, though, it is legitimate to ask, what do we do? And why do we do whatever we do? Do we only, let's just say, twiddle our thumbs, waiting for the day when God will wipe away all the tears? Is everything else only meaningful up to a point, if meaningful at all? That's one interpretation. And in fact, some argue that life day to day is only a time of waiting until the fullness of God's appearing. That's one interpretation. You know, that God, this will become real and meaningful and important when God closes the stage curtain of history. And then real meaning will begin. Folks thinking this way seem to conclude that time and history and relationships have no primary kingdom of God value in this life. And so you might say to me, well, preacher, that's really kind of extreme to even be talking about that. But sometimes it's important to define what the edges are so we can explore what's in the middle. Folks who say that there's nothing really meaningful that happens until God wipes away every tear at the end of time, that's their argument, and they're convinced that that's the line of thinking you ought to have, that I ought to have. But there is an alternative interpretation to God wiping away every tear, and I've recently become convinced, looking at this passage, that alternative interpretation is essentially the interpretation in which both of my parents believed and invested their lives without really talking about it specifically. My mother died in 2013 and entered into that sector of the universe where God, in God's way, wipes away every tear at the end of the time of someone's life. However, my mother on this side of the grave lived a witness of that alternative interpretation of the universe, where in God's way, we get a sense of what's in the future by faith, by what we cannot see, but we live invested in the present because of the teachings that we have received and a sense of the vision that is ours. And that in that alternative interpretation, the only meaningful wiping away of tears is not simply at the end of time. It is much more in this life for real. So given what I have seen in my life when my mother was alive, and what I have observed in watching her, this side of life and what we do is very important, and we'll get to that in just a moment. That God does wipe away every tear from our eyes at the end of time. But this alternative interpretation is that which actually, I'm convinced, the life of Jesus holds up for us, and certainly those from whom Jesus learned, and the scriptures in the Old Testament, and those who have since taught. Many folks. And we live on this side of death, and the portrait that is painted of a future with no time or history is meaningful today. So, what if this vision of the fullness of God's kingdom, which is victorious beyond suffering and death, is God's, let's call it a blueprint for the blessed future? What if this description of God's plan, where suffering and death are no more and tears are wiped away, is just that, a blueprint? Well, blueprint is probably not the most helpful image of the alternative interpretation, because a blueprint is a planned drawing toward which you work as a goal, and when it's achieved, you move on to something else. And you only hope that you can get there if it's an ultimate blueprint at some point. You may not can, but you hope that you can. But what if this biblical image is something different from a blueprint? You know, a goal out there that we either get to or don't get to. We either get assembled or don't get assembled. What if this passage is more along the lines of a template, a model from which we live and work according to that template? Even more than a template, maybe, what if it's a mirror image that we are looking to the writer of Revelation and the vision that he senses from God, and living the mirror reflection of what is described? So it could be that where we are now is living God's future in the time of history. Oh, sure, certainly, imperfectly, flawed, not getting it the way we would like it, and still with challenges and adversity. But if that is the case, that we actually are living from a template or a mirror image, then our lives today have and receive God's challenges, understanding that those challenges are actionable, as they say in the workplace. They call us and claim us for living in ways more than we might live left to ourselves, more than we do live left to ourselves. So it could be a pattern for our lives, couldn't it? Because it is a description of how God desires for us to live, how God intends for us to live, even in a flawed, imperfect, and still challenging world. So wouldn't it be then, not how time and history and relationships become perfect in the here and now, but rather, wouldn't it be for us then how time and history and relationships are crucial because it is the theater in which God's desires and intentions can be lived and lived by those who are called right in the middle of life. My mother was born in 1928. In 1948, before her 21st birthday, she passed the registered nurse state board exams and began working, I think, first as the county school district's traveling nurse, going to small rural schools. But before very long, she was working in the 24-bed county hospital. She was raised a Southern Baptist. In 1950, she joined the Presbyterian Church. In 1956, when she was 28, she identified publicly as a Republican and politically as a Republican. And those are what I call her participation labels. We all have participation labels. We all do. And they may change through the years for one reason or another. They're part of our lives, but they do not define our lives. My mother was no activist as such, but some of you may have seen, and some may have been old enough to be around when it came out, the 1954 movie White Christmas, wherein Rosemary Clooney and Vera Ellen sing Irving Berlin's song with the lyrics, "Sisters, sisters, Lord, help the mister who comes between me and my sister." And then it goes on to say, "Lord, help the sister who comes between me and my mister too." But we'll just stop with, "Lord, help the mister who comes between me and my sister." Well, in my mother's professional life, "Lord, help the doctor or the family member or the friend or the pastor or the hospital administrator or hospital board member or insurance company who came between my mother, the nurse, and the patients that she served and their best interests." Today, I think we might add to that list about her, "Lord, help the elected official or the non-elected official, the policy advocate or the religious zealot, including a religious judge who thinks that their perspective is the holy and the holy perspective and the beyond dispute perspective of what ought to happen for the patients and the citizens." My mother didn't care what someone's participation label was, hers or anyone else's, whether Protestant or Catholic, Christian or non-Christian, religious or non-religious, Democrat or Republican, independent or non-political, heterosexual or homosexual, upstanding citizen or convicted felon, younger or older. She worked with them all, and she saw them all as God's people. Equal access to quality care, which included a full range of services, that was her focus. In 1960, when she was 32, she began teaching young women and men who hoped to become licensed vocational nurses. They were Caucasian, Hispanic, and African American. In 1960. And Lord, help the person who came between my mother and the healthcare education of those students. For her, there was no distinction of race, ethnicity, gender, or income level. All were entitled to the same education opportunities and the same occupational opportunities, which in healthcare included being those who wipe away the tears from the faces of God's people. It is not that my mother did not follow the chain of authority and the medical orders given by physicians. She did. That was part of the way the institution of healthcare works then and now. But she was never shy about stating her opinion in private to a doctor who, in her opinion, was not considering the full range of treatment options that were available and the very best care for that patient before making decisions as part of a treatment plan. And in that community, all six of the primary care doctors who worked during her professional career knew that she considered the nursing team at the hospital to be the frontline caregivers with more moral and ethical allegiance primarily to the well-being of the patients than to anyone else. My mother's not the point of this sermon, though, but I'm going to go on just a little bit more. What shaped her to be who she was? Well, I've only thought about this since I've been considerably older and since she has died, but her anti-establishment leanings came, I think, from the historical roots of her Baptist tradition and her sense that institutions might function well for the protection and the best interest of every individual, majority or minority, conformist or dissenter. That came from her adopted Presbyterian roots. My mother never thought it was a good use of time or of God's gifts to steer clear of our own terror and rather stay very close to our respective comfort zones. We might not want to think about healthcare professionals and their terror, but have you ever thought the terror a physician feels, or a registered nurse, or a technician, when they are in a healthcare situation and everything seems to go south, as they say? When all adversity crops up in the care of a patient and the life situation is threatened, if not sliding downhill in a hurry. Well, my mother knew what it was like to face terror when you'd rather stay in your comfort zone. Three times from 1972 to 1978, she called me. Now, I was in 72, I was 19 years old, and in 78, I was 25 years old. She called me and she suggested, you know what that means. She suggested that I visit three different people in the hospital. The first one, and they all three were mortally ill. I began to wonder, is she ever going to call me to go visit anyone that's not in their last months? But the first, when I was 19 years old, he was suffering from lung cancer, and he was the husband of my ninth grade English teacher. 5 years later, or four years later, I was working in Pasadena, Texas as a pastoral intern, and I had completed 3 months of a hospital chaplaincy training. So I guess my mother thought I was, you know, the bar had now been raised and I was ready for another challenge. But I was living in the Houston area, so she asked me to visit a five-year-old who was the son of one of my dad's best friends, and he was a patient at MD Anderson with leukemia. And then just a matter of weeks, a few months later, she called me and asked me to make a visit to Methodist Hospital, where my eighth grade English teacher was a patient being treated for ALS in an advanced stage. All three of them died within weeks of my visit. I was terrified visiting my English teacher's husband and the five-year-old son of my dad's best friend. I was terrified. What in the world could I bring to a visit with folks in that situation when I really didn't know them all that well? And while I was not terrified visiting my eighth grade science teacher, I was immensely sad. So on this side of death, whether life is thriving or is sadly and agonizingly slipping away, what my mother knew that I was still learning, maybe still am, is that showing up for one another, and maybe we're not in the same room when we show up. It may be we write something or call or text something in this day. But showing up for one another respectfully, that's a key word, is one way that we practice working toward God's template and the mirror image of God's kingdom. When we, at least figuratively speaking, reach out to each other to wipe away the tears upon each person's face, though we may not actually ever physically make contact. It's a wiping away the tear through a soul connection, probably. Showing up respectfully in person, praying from a distance, speaking forth with advocacy, leaning into the terror of helplessness or feelings of inadequacy when people or points of view intimidate us, and when the threat or peril of suffering and death loom near to us or someone else. My mother, from a small town, expected and modeled respect for all. She practiced advocacy for all, and she leaned into, in her often gentle way, what intimidates and seeks to turn us back from serving with equal care and respect as that template and mirror image beckon us. Affixed with a magnet to her refrigerator door for many years were the lyrics on a piece of paper of George Matheson's poem, which we are about to sing. O love that wilt not let me go. Thinking about that, and how many times I couldn't open that refrigerator without staring those typed church bulletin lyrics in the face, I guess it's what you sing. If you are convinced that sometimes in the great by and by, God will wipe away every tear from our eyes, and it is also what you sing when you believe that for now, God desires and God expects that we will respectfully share in that tear wiping. in that advocacy practicing, and in the deeply respectful caring among others in the here and now. Why? Because Scripture holds up for us that template and that mirror image of Jesus Christ. For us, for everyone else. Why else do you think, when you think about it, why else do you think that Jesus would teach disciples to pray to God, "Your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven"? The simple answer in life, and life is neither simple nor easy, is this God's template and this mirror image communicate to us what God desired for Jesus to communicate in teaching that prayer. To put it on the side of God, "My kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven." That will always include the tear wiping and the advocacy practicing and the deeply respectful caring, even when the fear of suffering and death and the pressure from a majority or a minority and their opinions exert a pressured influence. That would be a pressured influence from which God desires that we not be intimidated and turn away. That's why I think my mother had the words to this hymn magnet held on her refrigerator door. "O love that wilt not let me go, who will not let anyone else go either." All honor and praise be to God.
While you remain seated, would you join us in singing that hymn, "O Love That Will Not Let Me Go," hymn number 833.
Let us pray. Gracious God, receive our humble thanks in recognition of your extraordinary world. For things great and small and beautiful and awesome, for seen and unseen splendors, for the important roles of parents and families, of being mothers, fathers, daughters, sons, sisters, and brothers. Receive our gratitude for simple pleasures found in Sabbath time of respite, reflection, recuperation, and rest. Receive our praise for the human experiences of talking, listening, singing, creating, playing, and thinking together, for common hopes and trials shared from birth until our dying. Give ear, we pray, to cries for rescue from violence, to cries for the silencing of weapons, to cries for every human being to be honored with equal respect. Give guidance to communities of faith as we seek to be faithful to the gospel, engaged with every neighbor, and led by the Holy Spirit. Bring healing to those who experience injury or infirmity, who agonize in body or emotion. Bring to wholeness each one who aches in soul and yearns in spirit. Bless our learnings and our doubt, that in questions and new perspectives we may venture to know you more completely. Bless words we exchange in relationships, that all people might be heard, known, and valued. It is more, this communion of the saints than can be contained by time and space. And so we rejoice in our eternal fellowship with all your people of past and present. It is more this life of ours than we deserve or expect. And so we pray for the grace to share life freely. It is more this call to follow Christ than we can accomplish alone. And so we pray together as Christ taught, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Would you join us in the song of dismissal? My life goes on. How can I keep from singing? Standing and singing together, hymn number 821. Hear the clear, though far off hymn,
Go now in the peace and power of Jesus Christ to be the people of God, serving as God will be leading. And may the grace of God strengthen, uphold, and transform your life, both today and forever. Amen.